As a game developer, I create thousands of landscapes, and the majority of these landscapes are created using Unity's terrain system. Over my time using this system, I have learned many useful tips and tricks, and today I'll be teaching you some of them. By default, terrains are set to static, which will cause Unity to start light map baking, which isn't good whilst creating your terrains, as it will slow down your system and also just be a massive pain. There are two ways to fix this. You can simply disable light map static on your terrain, or go into your lighting settings and disable auto generate. Sometimes when sculpting your terrain, you need to lower the height, and sometimes this isn't possible, due to hitting the minimum height of your terrain. So to stop this from happening, make sure to increase the height of your entire terrain prior sculpting. You can do this by navigating to the paint height section and inputting your desired height, and then simply pressing flatten. If you would like to increase the size of your terrain, you can do so by adjusting the width and height variables in the settings. This will, however, stretch out any already sculpted features. Depending on how large your terrain is, you may notice that you can no longer get small details. By increasing the height map resolution, you can remove this issue. Keep in mind that increasing this value will decrease performance. Ambient lighting has a large influence on the realism and mood of your scenes, and too often people just ignore this feature, leaving it at the default grey colour. For daytime scenes, the colour of your directional light should have a yellow tint, while the ambient lighting should have a blue tint. This will result in more realistic shadows. For nighttime scenes, the colour of the directional light should have a blue tint with a low intensity, whilst the ambient light should be dark and have a blue tint. If you want complete darkness, set the ambient light to black. The ambient lighting can also be controlled by a skybox, which is great if your skybox dynamically changes. In reference to the procedural skyboxes, which can be created by right-clicking in your project and selecting Create Material, and then clicking on the created material and selecting Shader Properties, Skybox, Procedural, the sky tint and ground color affect the ambient lighting. Now, fog isn't just used in, well, foggy scenes, it's also a great way to create an aerial perspective effect, which is when distant objects appear with a blue tinge. To enable fog, go into the lighting settings and scroll down to the bottom, and in other settings, you will see a fog parameter. For the best effect, match the color of your fog with your skybox, which can easily be done with the color picker tool. Finally, reduce the density, as you want this effect to be subtle. Unity's default directional light parameters have a weak intensity, which causes scenes to feel flat and unrealistic. So it is a good idea to increase the intensity of your directional light. I often use a value of 1.5. Increasing the intensity will also increase the contrast between your lit areas and your shadows. I find this contrast is an improvement, although if you find that it is too strong, you can keep the default directional light intensity and instead increase the post-exposure parameter, which is within the color grading section from the post-processing stack. Grass by default looks awful. Yet with a few adjustments, we can transform grass from this to this. So to do that, make sure that the healthy and dry color is set to white. Next, disable billboards. This will remove that creepy grass movement that always follows the player. With these settings, you may find that your grass stretches a lot in game. To get rid of this issue, simply go into the terrain settings and reduce the bending value. for that last bit of detail, apply some ambient occlusion using the post-processing stack. If you are unaware what this is, I have an entire video going over how to install and use the post-processing stack linked in the description. One of the most important visual components of a game is the ground. Therefore, it is important to spice it up with some diversity. This can be done with multiple grass textures, small bushes, flowers, and even stones and pebbles. If you don't have access to a range of ground models, you can adjust the height and color parameters of your current grass to cheat the effect. The base textures are also important, and you should use multiple textures and shy away from large patches of single materials, as this will cause the tiling effect to easily be noticed by the player. Applying additional maps to the textures, such as normal maps, is even better. Movement is an important element which can make your scenes feel alive. By default, your grass should move as if being blown by a breeze, which is great. However, trees won't be affected by default. So to get our trees moving, we need to add a wind zone to our scene. To do this, right-click in your hierarchy and navigate to 3D object, wind zone. The direction of the arrow is the direction of the wind. By default, I find that the strength of the wind zone is way too high. So I would recommend lowering the main attribute to something like 0.3. A lot of the time, you'll be sculpting mountains when working with the terrain system. So here are a few tips to create realistic mountains. Firstly, I like to use this brush and set a high size and low opacity. This way, we will have more control. And keep in mind when sculpting that your mouse should be constantly moving, as this will avoid regions becoming too steep. To start, slowly build up your foundation by circling the terrain. As your mountain gets steeper, reduce the brush size. Also, try to avoid that generic pyramid shape. Next, define particular branches of the mountain to create further variation. Once this is done, add sub-branches for that final level of detail. Viewing real-life images of mountains can also be a massive help to ensure realism. An easy way to create clouds is to adjust the particle settings of Unity's Dust Storm particle, available as a standard asset from their particle package. What you need to do is change the particle texture tint to white, then increase the particle size, decrease the particle speed, decrease rotation over lifetime, increase the start lifetime, and finally decrease the emission rate over time. Compressing this particle by reducing the game object size can also make a nice fog effect. Here are some useful features that you may be unaware of. When sculpting with the paint height tool, if you shift click, you can sample the target height. When erasing with the paint trees tool, if you hold Ctrl, you will only erase objects of the selected type. To hide trees and other detail objects while editing, you can go into the terrain settings and untick Draw. The F1 to F6 keys correspond to the various terrain tools. The comma and period keys cycle through the available brushes, Shift comma and shift dot cycle through the available objects for trees, textures, and details. Pressing the F key will focus the camera at the mouse's position on the terrain. So that's all for this video, and I hope you learned something new today. If you have any other tips and tricks, be sure to let me know in the comments below. With that being said, I'll see you in the next one.